I have been at CrossPoint for 6 years, on and off. And it took me up until this year to finally commit to the group that I'm in. I had been interested in getting in a group in probably the last year and a half and had to go home for a few different reasons for a little while. And after going home, I realized that if I wanted to be in a good place when I got back and I wanted to stay here, that I would have to really focus on my faith and build my relationship with Christ. And joining a small group was one of the next steps for me. After church one week, I had ran into a girl who I just knew through a couple mutual friends, and she had told me that CrossPoint's the group that she was involved in was open for new people to join. And she invited me actually that very next day. So the next day I showed up, and that's been my group ever since. It took me like 2 or 3 weeks to actually feel comfortable in my group. More of a me thing than anything else. Just wondering, like, am I gonna be judged or rejected, or are people gonna think I'm crazy? But it's really been awesome to see that we're all going through the same struggles and the same battles. They might not look the same, but we're all struggling. And it's Acts actually 2:44. I've been reading my Acts. Says that, and they all believed, and they were together and had all things in common. So coming together under the same purpose, to glorify God and to learn the scripture, is a bond that you can't create anywhere else.
Yes, and thank you, Elizabeth. And with that story, we're just reminded that we weren't created to do this alone. And when it comes to following Jesus, that we were made to experience community. We were hardwired for relationships and to follow Jesus with one another. And we're talking about movement, and we're talking about moving forward, and we're going to move forward in our lives. And if God's going to move in and through our lives, he's going to do it through relationships, through other people around us. Now, I absolutely love this season. I love this time. I love we get to start a new series. I love we get an opportunity to jump into groups in the fall. I love the kids are going back to school. Any students excited about going back to school? Any moms and dads excited their students are going back to school? Yes, that was the most spiritual moment of your morning, perhaps. Just that reflection and meditation on that truth. But yeah, we're excited. Excited that football season's cranking up. Any football fans in here? Any Titans fans in the house? Yeah, you thought you were until you saw this guy. I don't know if you've seen this, but this guy has 30 Titans tattoos. That's the number one Titans fan out there. It's interesting. One of his Titans tattoos says 2018 AFC South champions. He got that before the season began. He got that just believing. He has more faith than any of us in the room. And just this guy, just incredible fan. And I was looking at those tattoos and I was thinking about that. I was like, you know what? There's no hiding what you're devoted to. Like, when you're devoted, other people can see. Like, you know what that guy's devoted to, and people around you can tell what you're devoted to, too. Like, by looking at your life, and in fact, when we look at our own lives, we see the trail of our time and our energy and our thoughts and our conversation. We can look back and we can look at how we spend our money and our lives. We can see the things that we're devoted to, and this word devotion is going to sit as a centerpiece with what we talk about today. I want you to think about, like, in relationships, you know when somebody's devoted to you and you know when they're not. Think about the person that's most devoted to you, the most devoted person in relationship. What are some of the words that come to mind? Loyal, faithful, sacrificial, generous, helpful, selfless. When we think of devoted people, those are the words that come to mind. And we can't hide when there's devotion in relationship. You know, you see it, right? It's demonstrated. Makes me think, I was at a friend's birthday party a few weeks ago, and we went to this birthday party. It was a surprise party. You know the ones where you just can't really tell if they're surprised? You know, like, did they know? And it was just that moment, like, everybody, you know, we just couldn't tell, and we were sitting on the back porch, we were eating tacos, and then the surprise happened. Because we're on the back porch eating tacos, and the door opens, and this guy and his family walk through the door, and it's like this moment, like, what? Like, people are just going, no way. And there's like this bro hug fest going on. And it was just this moment of surprise. It was the biggest moment of surprise in the entire evening. And come to find out what had happened, they told us what had happened. We had no clue what was going on. And then they told us that the guy that walked through the door had driven 10 hours from Michigan to be at the surprise party. 10 hours from Michigan. He drove 10 hours for a surprise party. And I'm watching this and I'm going, I thought I was something because I sat in 45 minutes of Nashville traffic to get here, right? But then I'm watching this and I'm like, man, that's devotion. And as I'm watching them have this conversation, they hadn't seen each other in a while, and I'm watching this and I'm going, man, I wonder if I have a friend that would drive 10 hours for my birthday. And then I had this thought, like, I wonder if I would be willing to drive 10 hours for somebody else's birthday. See, when it comes to devotion, like I was going, that's one of the most devoted friends that I've ever seen. Now, with the disciples, if you had the disciples, who's the most devoted person that you've ever been around? They would say the most devoted person is Jesus. Because they'd never seen anybody that loved like him. He sacrificed, he served. They saw him, he shared, he gave his life away. They watched his life, and Jesus was devoted. He was devoted to God, and he was devoted to them. He was devoted to what he was called to do. And the disciples were not easy to be devoted to. Because they argued all the time. And they fought about, like, who was the greatest. And when Jesus told them, hey, it's time to pray, they fell asleep. And when Jesus was trying to sleep, they woke him up and asked him to pray. And they asked, should we call down fire from heaven on the Samaritans? And Jesus was like, no. I mean, the disciples, you look at their lives and you're like, okay, Thomas was a doubter. And Judas was a thief. And Peter cut off a guy's ear. But yet, even in all their hangups, Jesus was devoted to them. He said, I'm never going to leave you nor forsake you. He never turned his back on them. Jesus loved them faithfully and fully. He forgave them constantly. And Jesus was devoted to the disciples. And one time he said this, he says, no greater love has a man than this, than he would lay down his life for his friends. In other words, this is the greatest devotion that you're about to see. The highest expression of devotion is the cross. The ultimate expression of devotion in the universe is the cross. Because what Jesus wants you to know, if you're taking notes, you can write this down. You can go ahead and fill in the blanks. It's that God is devoted to you first and at your worst. Like, God is devoted to you first and at your worst. Look at Romans 5:8. Romans 5:8 says, but God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And what God wants you to know is that he is devoted to you at your worst. When you were strung out, when you were in the pit, when you were at the lowest moment of your life, when you were rebellious and running from God, when you were at your worst moment, even if it was on Broadway last night, when you were at your worst moment of your life. And listen, we can all think of our worst moment. It's the moment that the enemy brings to mind when he wants to heap on shame and guilt and condemnation. We know that worst moment. It's the moment that we hope never comes up at a dinner conversation. It's the moment that we kind of skip right over when it comes to our resume, and it's that gap. You know the worst moment, the moment that you don't want to think about. But when you think about that worst moment, you need to know that God loved you at your worst. That it was at that worst moment that you were worth dying for. While we were still sinners, while we were trapped in our sin, while we were at our worst, God says, I loved you. And I love you, and you are worth the cross. You are worth Jesus. At your worst moment, when the enemy brings that to mind, you need to know at that moment, you are worth dying for. And so he loves you at your worst, and at the same time, he loves you first. And it's not just because it rhymes, but I want you to see this verse. It says, we love because he first loved us. So what the scripture teaches is that the only way that we can love other people, the only way that we can love God and that we can love others, the only way we can even love ourselves, the only way that we love is because he first loved us. He beat us to it. He loved us first. So any devotion that we have in our life is this response to the devotion that he's given us. God was devoted to you before you were ever devoted to him. And his devotion to you doesn't have to do with your devotion to him. Like, he was devoted to you first and at your worst. And so it's that God loved you first. And we receive that love. And it's only when we receive that love that we can give that love, because you can't give what you don't have. But when you receive God's love, you realize, hey, he loved me first. And I had this moment where I just, I saw this in a way that I'll never forget. A couple weeks ago, I was invited to go under the bridge, Jefferson Street Bridge. There's a ministry that meets there called the Bridge. And it's the church under the bridge on Tuesday nights, and it's church for homeless in the city. And I was able to go and be with the volunteers that show up every single week and serve there. And it was incredible. They feed the homeless and then provide a church service there under the bridge and then leave them with even more food. It's just this beautiful display of God's love. And there was this moment in the service where the lady that was leading the service, though, she was leading worship, and she started to sing this song. She sang this song, "Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus." Don't laugh at my singing. "Oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me." And when she sang that song, I was like, I know that song. Like, I learned that song when I was a little kid. And so it was kind of one of those moments where I was like, man, that, like, it was nostalgic, the truth of that song. And then she did something that I didn't expect. She said, "Does anybody else want to sing?" And with the homeless men and women that were there, there was one lady that stood up, and you could tell she'd lived a rough life. And this lady gave her the microphone, and I got nervous because I was like, I don't know what's going to happen next. And this lady grabbed the mic, and she started to sing, "Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me." And in that moment, I just started to weep. Because in that moment, she went from being someone that we might see on the streets and maybe even drive by to being a daughter of the King. In that moment, I saw her as she was, as a child of God, and it broke something in me. And I realized the power, that truth, that he first loved you, that he first loved me. And that any love we have for him is because he first loved us. And it's his love for us that transforms us. And I hadn't forgotten the words to that song, but sometimes I can forget the truth of that song. I can think that his love for me is based on, like, how good I preach. Or his love is based for me on how good I am as a dad. Or his love is based on me on how good I am as a husband. Or how good I am as a friend. And when the times when I fall short, the times when I mess up, or the times I don't do my best, I can beat myself up because I forget the truth that his love for me is not based on how good I am. It's based on how good he is. And his goodness never ends. And it's because he first loved us that we can know him, that we can love him. And so there's a movement going on in the cities. And it's happening in the churches, and it's happening underneath bridges, and it's happening in Highland apartments with the refugees, and it's happening in the Teen Dream Center, and it's happening behind bars, and it's happening in locker rooms and classrooms and homerooms. This movement's happening in living rooms. It's happening all over because the movement of God can't be contained to the building. The movement of God moves throughout the city. And that's what we see in the book of Acts. We see the Holy Spirit comes down on the people of God, and the Spirit of God moves throughout. And you see God changed his address from the temple to the people. So instead of dwelling in buildings, God dwells in people. And you see the church just explode. There's this group of 120 that are meeting in an upper room. The Holy Spirit comes upon them. And then in one day, they go to being 3,000 people that are scattered throughout the city. And so we're enjoying, I hope you're enjoying reading through the book of Acts together. And if you missed last week, you can go listen and you can jump right in and you can read with us. We're reading a chapter a day. But what we're asking God and what we're praying is, God, would you close the gap? Would you close the gap between what the early church, the historical early church experienced, and would you close that gap, and would we experience it today in our lives and our time? Would you give us like a fresh sense of your power in our lives? Would you recalibrate us as the people of God to your purpose? And we're asking God to do that as we read. And he's doing that among us. And so we're going to jump in to Acts chapter 2, verse 42. Acts chapter 2, verse 42 will be where we start out today. If you've got your program, you've got scripture in the program for you. And what I want you to see, this word devoted is a word that Luke uses to describe the activity of what was going on in the early church. With me, Acts chapter 2, verse 42, it says, "And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers, and awe came on every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved." Now, this is the scripture that Elizabeth talked about earlier on. And so what I want us to do, and I want us to go through, and as we look at this, we go, what were they devoted to? Well, they weren't devoted to a religion. They weren't devoted to rites and rituals. They weren't devoted to these practices. They were devoted first and foremost to Jesus. Not to a religion, but to a relationship with the living God. And out of that relationship with Jesus, out of Jesus' devotion, they encountered God's love for them through Jesus and experienced His Spirit was poured out, and then their devotion back to God just had these expressions. They were more organic than organized. It was just these expressions of, and we go through and we see them in the text, the apostles' teaching, fellowship, breaking to bread, and to prayer. So these four expressions, and so what last week we talked about, the Holy Spirit is the power, the Holy Spirit is the engine, the Holy Spirit is the engine that keeps us moving forward. I want you to think of these four expressions, these four things as putting wheels on the car. Okay, so it's the Holy Spirit that gets us going, and it's the wheels that keep the car going in the right direction and keep us moving. And so you can have an engine without the wheels, and you can have wheels without an engine, but if you want movement, if you want to move forward, you need all of it together. And so let's talk through these four expressions together. The first is the apostles' teaching. Now, what's he talking about when Luke said they were devoted to the apostles' teaching? Who were the apostles? Well, the apostles, the capital A apostles, the apostles were the disciples. They were the 12 disciples. They were 11 after Judas dropped off, and then they voted another one in. If you've been reading, you caught up. So you got these 12 apostles. Now, these are the leaders of the movement. And so with these apostles, they're the ones who walked with Jesus, who talked. They were the ones who were with Jesus from the beginning. So they heard the thing that Jesus taught. They saw his miracles with their own eyes. These were the ones who witnessed and encountered Jesus after the resurrection. So these are the apostles. Now, what are the apostles teaching? Now, remember, Jesus gave them the Great Commission. He said, "I want you to go into all the world, and I want you to make disciples of all nations. I want you to baptize people in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and teach them to obey everything I commanded you." So what are the apostles' teachings? The apostles' teachings are the commands of Jesus. So Jesus said, "I want you to go teach them what I've taught you. I want you to pass that along." And so they didn't have a copy of the scriptures. The printing press hadn't been invented yet. Everybody didn't have their own personal Bible. They couldn't go to the Bible app on their phone. They couldn't reach over in the nightstand in the La Quinta and get a, you know, Gideon's Bible. Like they didn't have the scriptures in their hands. And so they relied on the apostles. So you got people gathering together in smaller groups around the apostles going, "Tell us what Jesus said. Like, tell us what Jesus did. Tell us about Jesus' life. How should we live in light of who Jesus is?" And so they taught the commands of Jesus. Well, what are the commands of Jesus? What are some of the things that Jesus taught us? He taught us to forgive and to be born again, to abide in him, to do good works, to avoid sin, to let yes be yes and no be no, not to seek revenge and love your enemies and give to the needy and pray and forgive others and fast and store up your treasures in heaven and don't worry and don't judge and seek him first and take care of the poor and beware of false prophets and keep the Lord's Supper. Show mercy. And go to the people, teach, and baptize them. I mean, can you imagine a world where we live these things? Like, Fox News and CNN would go out of business. They'd have nothing to report. You could actually watch SportsCenter on the TV, on the treadmill at the gym. It would be amazing. Like, and this is Jesus. He came to teach us how to live, to show us how to love. He said, I want you to put these things in practice in your life. And listen, you can't follow Jesus' teaching in your own power and in your own strength. You need the Holy Spirit for that. With the Holy Spirit, even with the Holy Spirit in you, you also need a community of people around you that are helping you, that we encourage one another in this. But when we say that Jesus, we're trusting Jesus, we're not just saying we're trusting Jesus that he's right about how to get to heaven when we die. We're saying that we trust that Jesus is right about everything. We're trusting that Jesus is right about what he teaches about money and about sex and about relationships and about caring for the poor and about servanthood. We're teaching that Jesus is right about eternity. Jesus is right about everything. And Jesus said, when you put these practices in your life, when you live these things, when you obey my commands, when you walk in this truth, he said, there's just freedom in your life. And if you'll do this, you'll experience freedom. And he says, that's how you bring the kingdom of God here. Jesus isn't just about getting us from down here to up there. He's about getting up there, down here through our lives. But the kingdom of God, the power and the presence of God, the rule and reign of God comes in living out the truth. And it's not just hearing the truth, it's doing the truth. Look at what James says. He says, this brother of Jesus, he says, but be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. See, when we only hear the word and don't practice the word, live the word, follow the teaching, if we're devoted to the teaching, we go, man, I want to follow this teaching. I want to apply it to my life. If we're just hearers of the word and not doers of the word, we deceive ourselves. But if we put it in practice, that's where the power is. And that's part of like devoting. Say, I want to be devoted, Jesus, to your word. By your grace, I want to follow it. I don't want to be like Ed. I don't want to be like Ed. I don't think you do either. I used to work out with Ed. I use that term loosely. Ed worked out at the gym that I worked out at. And Ed was, you know, an older guy. And he would come to the gym. And he had a towel on his shoulder. And Ed would walk around the gym. And Ed would have conversations with everybody. And we were there to work out. And you don't know Ed, but you know somebody like Ed. And he'd just walk around. And he'd have conversations with people. And Ed would sometimes, he'd go over. And the only weights I ever saw Ed lift were when he actually didn't lift a weight. He went over to that leg machine. You know the leg machine I'm talking about? You know the leg machine, like the thigh. Like I never questioned Ed's devotion to his inner thighs. Like he was really devoted to that muscle right there. But he would go and he would do this. And what was so creepy about Ed is that he would look at people while he did it. He would make eye contact. So if you're going to do either one, the out, the in, the out, if you're going to do that, like don't look at anybody in the eyes. That's a violation. Like don't look at people. Ed's looking at people and he's trying to have conversation. I'm like, Ed, I can't look at you. And I certainly can't talk to you when you're doing that thing. But see, Ed was showing up at the gym, but he wasn't working out. And how many times do we show up, but then miss the part about being devoted and saying, we want to practice this stuff. And I love the fact that it's practicing the stuff because none of us are getting it perfect. It takes a lifetime to learn how to live. But it's us saying, God, by your grace every day, would you help me put this into practice? Being devoted is not just hearing the word. Say, how do I apply it to my life as well? And we need the fellowship. We need other people for that. So they were devoted to the apostles' teaching, and they were devoted to the fellowship. Now, the Greek word here is koinonia. And this is the Christ in me ministering to the Christ in you. That word koinonia, it refers to like this coming together and like this mutual giving and receiving. And that word is also translated sharing. And it's not just sharing stuff. It's sharing our hearts and sharing our lives together. But it is sharing stuff. And we all have like koinonia moments. We have koinonia moments at the Keurig. You ever get the Keurig at the office at the same time as somebody else? You got your K-cup and they got their K-cup. And it's kind of like, what's going to happen next, right? You got a decision to make. Now, here's the thing. Like, making a decision about coffee is hard. But making a decision about coffee before you've had your coffee, like, that's even harder. And in that moment, you got a decision. Am I going to let them go first or me go first? And there's that moment, that koinonia moment, like, okay, I'm going to serve. I'm going to share. I'm going to give this opportunity to you. And that's involving a K-cup. But what we see in the book of Acts is that they were selling houses and property, that they were selling stuff to help care for one another's needs, that they were sacrificing greatly for the community, for one another. It was love like the world had never seen. The world had never seen a community like this. And that first century world was filled with hate. It was filled with elitism, filled with segregation. It was filled with political and religious oppression. And aren't you glad that we've evolved and we're not like that today? And in that first century world, God poured out a fresh move of his spirit and created a community like the world had never seen. And I believe God wants to do the same thing today in our lives and through our church and through our relationships. He wants to pour out his spirit. He's saying, I want you to be devoted to one another. I want you to see this. It was during Pentecost that God poured out his spirit. The Jewish festival and people came from nations all over and came together. So you've got every race, ethnicity, background. You've got all these people who have come together, different languages that were being spoken. They've all come together in Jerusalem. And God, in his sovereignty and his divine plan, he waited for that moment and said, I'm going to pour out my spirit on all nations because I have a heart for the nations. And God demonstrated that his favorite race is the human race. I'm going to say that again. His favorite race is the human race. And so any ideology that puts one race above another race, that's from the pit of hell. And so as the church, we're a part of a community where we are devoted to one another. And because of Christ and what Christ did on the cross, because his spirit has been poured out, that we have a love that shatters all boundaries. And there aren't boundaries in that way, that we love across boundaries. And when we do that, when we love across racial boundaries, when we love across ethnicities, when we love across political boundaries, the world has to take note. And Jesus said, this is how they'll know that you're my disciples, that you love one another. This is how they'll know that you're my disciples, by the way that you love one another. Because they can debate our theology, but they can't argue with our love. And Jesus said, I want you to have koinonia, this fellowship. It's one another. That you be devoted to one another. Be devoted to God and devoted to one another. And listen, that kind of fellowship, that can happen on a Sunday morning, like with a high five, with a handshake, with a hug. Like that, it can happen. But we need something deeper than that, a deeper friendship with God and friendship with one another. It just can't happen in a setting, in a large auditorium. It requires sitting across tables and living rooms and conversation. I was talking with a friend of mine, and he said, Kevin, he said, how many close friends do you have? I said, a few. He said, I mean, where you're really known and where you can be vulnerable and trust. I said, a few. He said, you need six. I said, why? He said, because after you die, there are going to be six people who carry your casket. And as they carry your casket, you want their eyes to be filled with tears because of the impact that you had on one another, because of the life that you shared, because of the relationships that you had, because of the memories that you had together. He said, you need to go for six. And I thought, man, that's going for six. And I told Drew Powell that, and he said, well, unless you're cremated, then you just need one. And I was like, like, thanks, Drew. I appreciate that. Yeah. Just keeping it real. So I don't know if you need one or if you need six, but I'm thinking we should go for six. And here's what I don't know. Maybe you're next, and all of us need more deeper friendships. And perhaps that next friend for you is in the room today, but we just don't find out when we're looking at the back of somebody's head. It requires conversation. It requires relationship. The first thing it requires is just being open to it. Say, God, would you bring more friends like that into my life? And God knows a lot of people. He has a lot of relationships. He's a great networker, and he can bring. But the first thing is to pray and just say, God, would you do that? And then a next step would be to groups. Now, let me say this. I think I can hear about the guy that drives 10 hours. I'm like, oh, I wish I had a friend like that. But can I tell you, the great power of having a group of committed friends where we meet together every single week. See, sometimes I can overestimate the value of the guy who would drive 10 hours, but then I under maybe value the power of showing up in people's lives every single week and that consistency. And that's what being in a group, and guys that I share my struggles with and that we encourage one another and we pray for one another, it's powerful. And if you don't have that in your life, I'd encourage you to take a next step. All across our campuses today, we have an opportunity to take the next step in groups, and I encourage you to look toward that. And I don't know that you'll find like your next BFF, you know, and you'll have the little necklace that, you know, one of you have one half, one of you have, I don't know where that came from, probably because I have teenage daughters, but like, I don't know that you'll find your next best friend, but I believe that you can find your next friend. And I believe there's somebody that needs a friend like you, but it requires that we are vulnerable and brave and we take the next step toward that. We all need relationships like that. They were devoted to one another in the fellowship. Now, let me just say that the community is not a commodity to be consumed. It's a gift that you give. It's like, I need relationships. It's not, I don't know what that was either. Where we vacuum the life out of other people, right? Because we're like, I need community. It's not a commodity that you consume. It's a gift that you give to other people. And groups are a way that happens. They're a place that can happen. You can take the next step today. In fact, out in the lobby, there are green balloons. You just follow the green balloons, lead to somebody with a green shirt, and begin to have a conversation about how you can take that step as well. And then it says they were devoted to the breaking of bread. Now, they were devoted to eating. Some of you are like, this is good. Like, I'm already there, already really devoted to that. But breaking bread wasn't so much about what they were eating as who they were eating with. Look, it says, and day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. Now remember, Pentecost had just happened, and everybody had come into Jerusalem, and God moved in Jerusalem. There was a movement going on, and nobody wanted to leave and go home. Like, people didn't want to go home. They wanted to stay and be a part of it. So you've got all these people going in, and you don't have enough hotels. You don't have enough Airbnbs. You don't have enough for all these people to stay. And so what people were having to do is open up their homes and open up their pantries and open up their wallets. They're having to open up their lives in order to share with one another. And it was through eating together, that breaking of bread, the pulling up chairs at the table, that they shared their lives with one another. And it may mean that you have lunch with somebody that's at the office that you know could use a friend like you right now. Or it may mean that you schedule and you put it on the calendar to have a family into your home, but it begins to go, okay, we're going to open up our homes and our lives. And it says breaking bread. It's also referring to, in the Jewish tradition, bread and wine were a part of every meal. And so he's wanting us to know that they were partaking communion together, that they were remembering Jesus, that Jesus was at the center of their lives and their conversation and their meals. They broke bread with one another. They were devoted to that, but then they were also devoted to prayer. Now, prayer is simply prayer is conversation with God. In any relationship, the strength of any relationship is based on the communications. Communication with spouses, communication with parents, communication with kids, communication with friends, communication with God. And prayer is that conversation, that relationship with God. Now, as a church, we've been asking God, we're like, God, would you teach us how to pray? Would you teach us how to pray? But we learn how to pray with others. When I wanted my kids to learn the English language, I didn't shut them in a room somewhere and say, go learn how to speak English. I immerse them in conversation. And we learn how to pray by praying with people who know how to pray. Just like we learn to speak English, we learn that in conversation with other people. We learn how to pray by praying with other people. And Jesus said, when two or three of you gather together, I'm right there in the middle. Like, I'm right there with you. He promises his presence. And when Jesus shows up, when we're praying, he's not showing up with a clipboard counting our these and thous. He's not like grading our prayers and our religious vernacular. Jesus, in that moment, what Jesus is doing is he's showing up with his power and with his presence. Jesus isn't so much concerned with how you sound when you're praying. He's concerned with your heart. And he's just going, would you open up and just talk with me? In fact, one time Jesus said, I intercede. Like, I'm interceding for you, which means Jesus is praying for you all the time. Like, that's really good news. Jesus is praying for you, and that also means as an intercessor that Jesus is correcting your prayers. So sometimes you just pray something crazy, and Jesus goes, Father, what she really meant to say was. So Jesus is interceding for you. And what I love about this, it just takes the pressure off. So now you can just talk to God. You can have a conversation with God. It's like when the kids, when they bowl with, like, the bumpers on the, you know what I'm talking about? Yeah, shake your head, yeah. So, like, when the kids bowl, and in that moment, like, the pressure's off. God's going, the bumpers are in the gutters. You can't mess up. Just pray. Just have conversations. He just wants to hear from you. Because we look in the book of Acts, we see that whenever the church prays, that power takes place. They experience God's power. They pray for the Holy Spirit. They pray together and the Holy Spirit comes. They pray for new leaders and choose their leaders and God gives them wisdom. Peter gets locked up in prison and they start praying and he gets delivered. I love that time. They're praying for Peter to be delivered. And then Peter comes in, he comes to the door and he knocks on the door and he's like, hey. And they're like, the girl runs back in. She's like, Peter's at the door. They're like, well, why didn't you let him in? I mean, and sometimes the things that we're praying for is right outside the door and we're still praying. And God said, I just want you to pray because when you pray, that's when I show up in power. Jesus is like, I'll show up, but get together, a small group of you. I think the reason that Jesus prefers groups of two or three is because he can get a word in. You know what I'm saying? It's like, you just get a small group. Like, I'm right there with you. But other people, their faith encourage us. And it's powerful. And maybe for you, that next step would be to pray with somebody else. In fact, at the end of the service, we're at all of our campuses, we're going to have prayer team up front. Maybe there's something you need prayer for. And you say, why do we pray as a church? Why aren't we devoted? Because we've seen God answer prayer. We've seen God heal people. We've seen God restore marriages. We've seen God set people free from addiction. We've seen God open wounds. We've seen God heal hurts and hearts. We've seen God work miracles time and time again. And so at the end of the service, Maybe you say, oh, you need prayer for something, then we would invite you that a way you can be devoted to prayer is just ask somebody today. We would love to pray with you. They were devoted. They were devoted to the apostles' teaching. They were devoted to fellowship. They were devoted to the breaking of bread and to prayer. And because they were devoted to all these things, I love this verse. It says, and the Lord added to their number daily. The Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. It wasn't just that people were coming to Jesus on their worship and their large group gathering. It wasn't just Sunday worship where people come to Jesus. It was every single day. Because people saw from their life and the way they love Jesus and the way they love one another, it was so attractive that people were like, I want to be a part of that. Can I tell you something really cool? I can't remember a Sunday when at one of our campuses there wasn't somebody who came to Jesus or was baptized. And it's happening every single week across Middle Tennessee. And that's amazing. But I believe what God wants to do is he wants it to be every single day. And the way that it happens every single day is that we devote ourselves to him, but not because we have this great devotion that we can muster up, but because he was first devoted to us. And so I want to pray for you in those ways. Would you stand? Give me an opportunity to do that. So since the heart is the seat of the emotions and it's the center of who we are, and Jesus came to set our hearts free, he came that we would fully live. I just want to invite you to put your hand on your heart. Jesus, you tell us in your word that our hearts are the wellspring of our lives. It's the center of our lives. And it's where everything flows from. And we pray, would you help us understand your devotion to us? I pray for those today that just need to receive your love. Not based on how they do, but based on what you've done on the cross. Would you just fill their hearts with your love? Would they have an encounter with your love today? And with a greater understanding of your devotion toward us, God, would you help us devote ourselves toward you and toward what you call us to? By your grace, by your spirit, by your power, would you give us a greater appetite for your word? And then would you give us the grace to put it into play in our lives? God, I pray that we'd be devoted to one another, that when the world sees the way that we love other people despite our differences, that they would be drawn to you. They would see a love that comes only from heaven. And God, I pray that we would open up places at our tables, that we would break bread with one another, that we would share meals and share our hearts and share our lives. And then I pray for a continued just prayer awakening for us. God, I pray that you give us the courage and give us the words to pray. Give us the courage to get together with a small group of people and have a conversation with you. Even give some courage today to come forward and to ask for prayer, the prayer team. And God, that we would continue to see you move in miracles and you get all the glory. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Have a great week.